And that's it.
Different and more
substantive conversations about taxation throughout the world, not just in Ireland, not just in the United States, not just in the EU. So the word tax haven, which was used in my little run this morning, I'll say over 24 times, and I didn't run that long. So a country that makes 4 out of 5 of every medical stent used in the world to promote health doesn't sound like a tax haven. The country that produces one half of all of the ventilators used in hospitals across the world to promote health doesn't sound like a tax haven to me. I've used these criteria, you've heard them many times from people a lot smarter than me, that Ireland is attractive to especially American multinationals because it's an English-speaking country that uses the euro, that is in the EU, that has a very well-educated and dependable workforce. But I have often said that in a 12.5 transparent corporate tax rate, I have said on many times that I believe that all those are true, but the real reason that the businesses have done so well in the United States businesses have done so well in Ireland is because simply we just get one another. You know, that's not an economic theory. You can't teach a class on it, but that's really why it works. We just get one another. And I think that if I were trying to prove that proposition, and maybe I will have to one day, I would say take a look at the American multinationals in Ireland and see who is running them. Okay? And the answer to that question is they're almost all being run by Irish people. Intel, for example, has invested $12.5 billion in their facility here on the outskirts of Dublin. And that facility is run by Amy Sinnott, a lifelong Irishman. And that's true for almost all of the American multinationals here. That doesn't sound like a tax haven. So the thought about tax cheat. So the American multinationals that are working here, I spend a great deal of my time with them. It's part of my portfolio. And I believe that they are fully committed to compliance with the laws of Ireland and with the regulations here in Ireland, not just tax, but in every other environmental, labor, all of the other aspects of it. Is it a corporation's duty to minimize its taxes? Yes, it is. They're not in business to pay unspecified taxes, but they are in compliance. So this $13.5 billion creates a big issue on its own, as I said, it spurs a conversation about global taxation and rules so that we can all come to some agreements. But for Ireland right now, you've got the issue of, what is that going to do with a loan? We've got that issue. Plus, what is it going to do to other foreign direct investment? What will it do to the relationship between Ireland and the United States, between Irish people and American people, between the Irish government and American multinationals? And I am optimistic that we will find our way through this. I'm optimistic about that for a whole bunch of reasons, and I'll give you just a few. One is history. When my own grandparents left Ireland about 100 years ago, without a penny, but with lots of hope, they took with them Irish values, religion, they took with them their culture and their history. And Irish immigrants, as you all know, Irish immigrants to the United States became, first of all, our laborers, and then eventually they became our priests, and eventually they became our poets and our playwrights, and eventually one of them became a president. And we carry, in the United States, we carry with us that feeling about this land and the beautiful people who live here. And so we'll get through this. There are 700 American companies currently doing business in Ireland, doing very well here. There are about 250 Irish companies doing very well in the United States. We have found that our markets are compatible to one another. American people like dealing with the Irish. Irish people apparently like dealing with the United States. And what started off as a relationship between poor immigrants sending back a few dollars during Christmas time to their relatives in Ireland has blossomed into a real economic engine that has produced hundreds of thousands of jobs, hundreds of thousands of quality, well-paying, middle-class establishing, pride-inducing jobs on both sides of the Atlantic Ocean. Let me talk about two gifts that in some ways summarize this relationship. One, a small gift that occurred within the last year, within the last 12 months, and another gift that occurred, much bigger gift that occurred some years ago. The first gift was from Ireland to the United States. Maybe you haven't ever heard of this, but Ireland recently digitalized church records, genealogical records. Meaning for the very first time, Americans who economically aren't able to come to Ireland, or for health reasons, are unable to come to Ireland, can for the first time trace their genealogic history. I cannot tell you how many pieces of correspondence I have received from Americans thanking Ireland for that. It's the kind of things that friends do for friends. You didn't have to do it. But a lot of Americans who've been curious about their history, who want to know about their Irish roots, but who just couldn't get here, now can do that. You didn't have to do that, but you did. The second gift I'd like to talk about just for a second is our keynote speaker, Senator George Mitchell. President Clinton didn't have to send Senator Mitchell here. There'd be a lot of reasons not to get involved in what he was asked to get involved in. But it's the kind of thing that friends do for friends. And now, for full disclosure here, I have to say that I am the self-appointed president of the George Mitchell canonization. he doesn't know that, by the way, but I am. I've had a chance to read some of the non-public issues floating around that, and I will tell you, if I didn't believe in divine providence, which I do, I have become an even stronger believer in divine providence, that he was actually the absolute right person to pick for that job. Nobody could have done it better than Senator George Mitchell. And it's the kind of things that friends do for friends. He came here really sort of by himself. Had this very, 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 very small staff of a couple of people. It wasn't like we sent the first Marine Ranger Division, which was about 40 tons of diplomacy. We sent one diplomat, George Mitchell, and he worked through, in many ways, a very significant problem, and we're all the beneficiaries of that. And that's the kind of thing that friends do for friends. So I'm optimistic about getting through this current issue. I think history is on our side. I think we have so much shared DNA that's on our side. And as I said just a few seconds ago, I think we get one another and we'll find our way through this issue. hope we get through it in a way that we're not throwing around terms like tax cheat and tax haven irresponsibly. I hope that the discussion is a is an intellectual one, and that I hope that we can resolve this all in a global sense very quickly. The heart of the U.S.-Irish relationship is today and always has been its people, how we get along. I think this the celebrations this weekend are really exemplify that we're all coming together for the two great academic institutions, and just for some good spirited fun on the sidelines, have a few serious discussions, and hopefully we can progress the relationship further. We are very lucky, I think, us Irish us Americans and you Irish, to have such a great relationship. May it continue on forever. Quarter meal now.